Kathy and Roger for having us today, and thank you to all of you for coming out. I'll give you a few remarks before we start. Welcome to the Playwriting Short Play Festival, a showcase of new original plays written by students in my English 587 playwriting and screenwriting class, as well as by folks in our community and region. I want to thank all of those who helped make today possible, including our student and community playwrights, actors, and directors. And we also want to thank Director of Theater Jim Bartruff and Professor Theresa Mitchell,
she's
somewhere
here.
Around here, for helping spread the word. We really appreciate it. Once again, a big thank you to Roger and Kathy as well, and to the William Allen White Community Partnership and the Kansas State Historical Society for lending this rehearsal and performance space. Reader's Theater shows, it offers an opportunity to test drive new work by new playwrights, to see their audience laugh, cry, and sigh in the right places as the play moves through revision to eventual production. About half of the plays today are on a theme of love, since we're almost to Valentine's Day, and I hope you appreciate that and enjoy it. I want to thank you for being a part of this process. At this point, if you could mute or turn off all beeping and chiming devices, because if we're going into a lovey-dovey moment and we hear the signal for the ringtone for Sex in the City, it might compliment the acting, but it might not. So there's that. I do think there's a little bit of PG-13 material, so I think you'll be okay. We just wanted to give you a forewarning. I want to tell you what your handouts are. One is a program, so it tells the plays and tells where the playwright is from, so that should be fun. Names all the actors and directors, etc. There's also a little slip of paper which talks about the coming visiting writers series for creative writing. So actually one of the things, the second thing is this, and then on Monday, February 27th, Mary Frances Wagner and Greg Field, poets from Kansas City, will be here 7 to 8 p.m. in the Preston Room in the Memorial Union. So there are a bunch of other free events related to creative writing happening this semester, and you can come and all of those are free and open to the public, so you can come enjoy those as well. Without further ado, let's go ahead and launch into our festival. Thank you for coming. Let's give a hand for our first show.
Parking lot, day. Guy and girl have exited the coffee shop. He has walked her to her car. She nervously unlocks the door, tosses her purse and keys on the seat, then turns to him. Guy.
Well then.
Gal. Well then. They stand facing each other, hands in respective pockets. His eyes go soft, hers go questioning. They shift slightly towards each other. She parts her lips. There's a moment, and then, yeah, blurting. It's been great, thanks for the coffee. She hops forward, bouncing on the balls of her feet so she can reach him, and plants a quick kiss on his cheek. She turns before he can say anything and hops into her car, briefly pausing to flash a smile and wave. Guy, waving defeatedly. Till next time. Dissolve to...
Wait, you gotta be kidding me. This is not...
Perfectly serious. And what's wrong with the ending other than it isn't exactly what we discussed?
Well, that's one thing.
There's more than one thing. Enumerate.
All right, two. It's not an ending.
That's the point.
Well, we agreed.
You insisted. I never agreed.
We compromised.
Never mind. Next.
All right, three. After all that buildup, we need at least a proper kiss. I mean, we have established an electric connection between the two of them. The kind that people wet themselves over in movie theaters. Talking in a coffee shop for hours, after a moment of danger and kismet, and then you want to end it as if it's some most awkward high school dates trope? I won't believe what happens next.
This is more realistic. Not everything ends in violin, swelling, kiss, fade to black. Audiences want to see themselves.
But this is film. And we are writing a film. Audiences want fantasy.
And Adams took it for a cookbook, obviously. Look, I just got into their heads as I was editing, and have you ever considered that maybe these characters deserve more?
More.
More than one predictable ending. More than one short film.
The sequel?
A series. These are some of the best characters we've written in the last couple of years, with a very unique beginning, and I want to see where we can take them. Why go for the obvious romantic wrap-up? Why shortchange ourselves? I want to delve deeper. They've got more to them, I know it.
Deadlines! Like, we don't have time to fuss over rewrites or draft an entire series with the scripts.
Why limit ourselves to the festival? Can't deny that the entries the last couple of years have been a little immature.
Yeah, but we won.
Exactly! It's not much of a race when you're running against people with their shoes tied together.
But we won.
Don't you want more?
More than winning.
More than followers, sponsors, paying deals, a future. We can't live in this post-college limbo forever.
It's worked out so well so far. Besides, this script, you've taken it in a completely different direction. The characters, she's turned out flaky, and he seems so impotent, the way you've written it.
Sometimes characters go rogue, and they turn out better than you could have ever imagined.
Well, not my characters.
You mean our characters.
Those are not our characters. Those are your characters.
They're ours, just optimized.
They were fine the way they were, the way we agreed in the read-through.
Oh, forget the read-through! You can't always write the story the way you want. Sometimes you have to let the story tell you.
You've been talking to Jeremy again, haven't you?
What?
No.
Why'd you say that?
The series and the non-ending, the changing characters, those ideas just came to you.
Look, we can still make it work for the festival and
keep
ourselves open to possibilities.
Tonight, suddenly our ideas are better as a series? I mean, how many drinks did it take for him to get you to jump ship?
Look, if we edit here, and then look, are you upset that I talked to him or that I'm right?
Neither.
Then why?
Well, he's our strongest competition. I mean, discussing our deal with him? You're opening us up for sabotage.
That's a level of paranoia I didn't think you capable of. Besides, it's not him I'm worried about.
What does that mean?
Maybe I need someone to listen. Really listen to my ideas for a change.
I listen. I try to incorporate as many of your ideas as mine. When they work.
Do you even hear yourself, Davis?
I'm supporting you. I'm agreeing with you.
You're patronizing me.
How am I?
Just like every time I suggest something that might take one of our projects in a direction that you can't completely control.
That is not true. Just this doesn't seem like us anymore.
Admit it.
Admit what?
You're jealous.
It's ridiculous. Why would I be jealous of that Scorsese wannabe and his inferior ideas?
Not of Jeremy.
Well, then what else is there for me to be jealous about? You sleep with him?
What?
You did. And you slept with him. And tell him by the way you say his name.
That is not the point.
What is the point?
You can write it, but you can't admit it.
What are you talking about?
Man, you're worried that I'll be better than you without you.
Well, it's not like
you're afraid of what you'll be or what I'd be if we weren't us.
By doing something stupid.
Cut me loose and I might be better than you, and you can't stand it because you love. Davis, am I right? Davis?
No, and four, it's a shitty ending because it's not an ending. And that was number three. Four.
Fine. This script isn't us anymore. It's yours.
Hey, I'm a writer. I tell the story.
Exterior, parking lot, day. Guy and gal entered the coffee shop and he has walked her to her car. She nervously unlocks the door, tosses her purse and keys in the seat, and turns to him. Guy, laughing gently. Well then. Gal, he was nervously. Well then. They stand facing each other, hands in respective pockets. His eyes go soft, hers go questioning. They shift slightly towards each other. She parts her lips, there is a moment, and then, gal, blurting. It's been great, thanks for the coffee. She hops forward, bouncing on the balls of her feet, and plants a kiss on his cheek. She turns to go, but he catches her, and he pulls her close. One arm circling her waist, one hand weaving through the hair at the back of her neck. Got it. All afternoon, I've been watching your lips shape words, wondering how they feel against mine. Gal, guess we should solve that mystery. They kiss, warmly with restrained passion. Evident they both want more until she breaks the kiss, smiling. Gal, till next time. She grins seductively, moves around to get into her car, stopping to blow him a kiss and wave before she gets in. Guy, till next time. He waves encouragingly, watches her drive away, thinking about next time. Fade to black.
When I finally drew a pair and gave us a long overdue title.
Yeah?
2 months from now is the anniversary where we finally told your brother about us.
You remember the exact date?
And 4 months after that marks the day I kissed you non-consensually at the kegger party.
You were drunk?
I was an idiot.
You apologized the next day.
Yeah, and I'm still convinced you only forgave me because I'm cute.
All right, so what's today's anniversary then?
Today marks 6 years since I baked you cookies for the first time.
Really?
Remember, we were at your dad's house for the weekend, and he left a tub of cookie dough in the fridge for us while he went to work?
Was that the time you burnt yourself on the baking tray?
It was heavy.
Was that before or after you had a crush on me?
Would you believe me if I said it was before?
No.
Well, it was. Speaking of cookies, the last one's all yours.
That's okay, I don't eat it.
Neither do I.
You made them, you should have it.
I made them for you, and I've had plenty.
Says the guy who told my dad, too many is still not enough, last Christmas.
I was talking about his snickerdoodles. They're better than anything I could ever scrounge up.
Maybe. But your chocolate chip surprise comes in a close second.
You say that because you love me.
You and your cookies.
I don't understand. How have you been dealing with my culinary skills for this long? Last I checked, I was pretty crappy making anything more complex than a PB&J.
Who told you that?
Your mom.
You really shouldn't take everything my mother says to heart.
You know she hates everything I make. I mean, hell, she hates me. Anyway.
She doesn't hate you. She just criticizes everything you do.
Is that not practically the same thing?
She likes you. She's the same way with Christine.
Your sister-in-law?
Ever since she married my brother, my mother's always been giving her a hard time. I'd say she's kind of worse than you, actually.
Well, I guess that's reassuring.
My mother likes you. She was skeptical of you at first, but she's my mother. That's what moms do. Your mom was like that with me when we first became official.
Yeah, she was, wasn't she?
I'm sorry, I didn't mean to bring her up.
No, it's okay. It's been 3 years, so I ought to be over it by now.
But you're not. That's okay.
I love you. You know, when my parents died, your dad, well, you know, he was almost like a...
Yeah, I know.
Maybe we should split.
What?
The cookie.
Oh! yeah, sure. I guess half of one more won't put us both in a sugar coma.
Even if it did, at least we'd be together.
Sure.
You know, whoever invented the baker's dozen probably didn't consider the potential problems for serving to an even number of people.
I don't think you realized you were baking that many for only two people.
Want to go another round?
What, of your one-word game?
Yeah.
I don't know, it's getting kind of late. I wanted to get a good 8 hours sleep tonight.
Just one.
Maybe tomorrow.
Please?
No thanks.
Oh, come on, just one more.
Love you, dork. Good night.
Us.
What about us?
Together.
Really? I never would have guessed.
Four.
Four what?
Years.
4 years? Has it really been that long?
Yeah.
Wow.
Forever.
Compared to my parents, definitely.
Us.
Yes, you said that.
Forever.
You're repeating yourself now.
Evie.
What?
Forever.
What's forever?
Us.
Wait.
Always.
You mean you want that too?
Yes.
And curtain.
It's Tad.
Oh, is it? Is it getting worse?
So I'm up to bat, and the coach gives me the signal. Take the first pitch. And I do. Ball. And the bad pitches keep coming, and we're up to ball three, and the coach signals, don't swing. And the pitch is high and inside, and though I'm small, my mind is strong, iron tight. And I don't move. And the ball hits me in the head, right between the eyes, and I go down like a sack of potatoes, a bag of hammers, a bucket of bolts, and the coach sees I can stand. And when I'm up, I'm on first base, proud. I'm not so good a hitter, but I can stand here and get hit, walk. Nobody's hitting, so the coach is happy, glad I've made it to the base, even if I made it here without a single swing. So, one of the guys on the team says, "What kind of a sissy thing is that? You've got a Band-Aid on your back." And I do. I put the Band-Aid on this morning before practice. When my mother said, "You know, you can't skip baseball." And I said, "Do I have to go?" And she said, "It'll be good for you." But it's not. Already, I'm being heckled. What do they know? What they don't know is that my cat died yesterday. And my mother, father, and I put him into the ground last night with a shovel. And I put the final hard, dry clump on top and said, "So long." We hunt birds together under a tree, Scat Cat biting me if I made too much noise. Another time, Scat Cat had ridden a Doberman out of the yard who'd come in barking at me. Scat Cat plunged onto the dog's back, claws dug in deep. They call me the pop-out king because I swing a little too soon, catch the bottom of the ball, and though I swing hard for the fences, the ball pops up, spins, and falls right into an easy infielder's glove. But today, I'm slower. I take my time in grief. And when the ball comes, I hit it square for once. And the ball flies and flies over the infield and over the outfield and over the orange mesh fence used to keep the dirt in. And I round the bases for once. My bat in the grass, Band-Aid on its front. Don't I know you? No. Wait, it'll come to me. No.
Where are you from, sweetie?
Here. I grew up in Shawnee.
What street?
59th and Hawkins.
Really? I dated a guy over there. People call him Smooth. His name was Harold.
I knew Smooth. He lived across the street. Always had a group of cool kids around him. And his big black Camaro.
Cool kids? I'll bet I was one of them. Did you hang with him?
No! I was 10 then, too young, and shy. I sold those high schoolers lemonade.
Really?
And one day, this beautiful red-haired girl, instead of giving me a tip, gave me a kiss on the cheek. That I never forgot. Chalk it up to one of the finest days of my youth. A kiss as a tip.
Really?
Couldn't be you, though. You're blonde.
Yes, I am, sweets. Through and through. Who usually cuts your hair?
Supercuts?
Really? Kind of cheap, huh, sugar?
Just not Pinky, I guess.
Sure you can afford me?
I'll do my best. Maybe I just lack style. Can you give me style?
Anything I do for you will give you more style than you already have.
Really?
Trust me, I know what I'm doing. This is my place, this is what I do. Business cut?
Sure, business cut.
Better than round the ears?
Sure. What's your name?
Isabel.
James, good to meet you. Style me up, will ya? Like Buddy Bolden might.
Who?
Buddy Bolden? The first jazz musician. He was a barber days and played flugelhorn nights. Walked in front of Mardi Gras parade, bright horn in the clouds. A new song coming in from the magic flugelhorn. Oh, the first brilliant soloist.
Really? I don't play.
Sing?
Only in the shower.
Do you like jazz?
You mean like Kenny G?
More like Charlie Parker, Miles, Coltrane, Keith Jarrett?
They any good?
Let me tell you. They make Kenny G look like Fabio just holding a horn.
Is that bad?
Well, at least G looks good.
Are you sure you want a business cut? Maybe I need something jazzier.
Any hair left?
Enough. Want a little long in the back?
Your call. Make me stylin'.
I'll make your hair hot, hot as I can. Ready for that?
I could use some heat. Some Armstrong's Hot 5 heat.
Two girls will turn their heads to look at you when I'm through.
I could use some of that.
Really? You seem like you'd get plenty of looks, sweets.
Maybe. No, not so much.
Oh, but you're a charmer at work.
I wouldn't notice. I teach college. Undergrads are off limits.
Must be tough. What do you teach?
English composition days and play jazz nights.
Make a lot?
No, but pays those bills, and I guess that's why I...
Supercuts?
You're sweet.
Sweet? I'm probably a decade older than you. Sure I'm not.
I might be able to catch up.
You can't run out outrun time.
I can try. I listened to music decades before my time. Spin the LPs trying to bring that sound into my hands, sticks.
Drummers. Timekeepers. Rumblers?
No, drummers are more than that. Drums are the drug, the poetry, the kiss.
The kiss?
What starts it all? A touch. A kiss.
Not bad.
That kiss with the lemonade, it jump-started my youth.
Really?
It drummed my blood for years. All I could think of was that girl.
Who tipped with a kiss.
I've seen and known wilder things since, but it was the hotness. That honest and sweet and simple.
For a little guy.
For a kid who only had lemonade. Full cup of lemonade.
I'll bet that got you going, Trigger.
Still does.
You know, I have a confession, James.
What's that?
My hair's not always been blonde.
Al?
I dyed it. I dyed it in high school.
Really? Red?
Yep.
So you were...
Yep, sweets. So I was that girl.
My first kiss.
Right on the cheek.
But I heard that redhead was in a bad wreck. Smooth took a country road curve way too fast and flipped that car. Messed up him and the girl. Plastic surgery to the face. You look too good to be her.
Scars. Even now I keep my hair long enough to cover them.
I'm sorry. I'm so sorry.
It's okay, kid.
You're still a true beauty to me, Isabel. Scars and all.
Oh, you're just saying that.
No, I mean it. I love every bit of your terrain.
Really? Every bit? There's more to know.
Bet there is. When do you get off work?
You're my last one.
Can I buy you a drink? I've got a place in mind.
Far?
Just 15 minutes.
My part of town?
We'll broaden your horizons.
Safe?
Safe enough. Besides, you've got me.
They serve vodka tonics?
What, no lemonade? I thought you were a lemonade girl.
Well, that was a long time ago.
You're gonna love it. This place downtown at 8th and Vine. The Blue.
You think I can like jazz?
You'll love it. You'll savor this new music, sweeter than any lemonade.
Can anything be sweeter?
Golden jazz can. Played by a subterranean god.
Subterranean god?
You know, Keurig, the Beats, jazzers were their gods.
Gods. My name's on a cross.
Then untack him and take him down and dance.
Dance?
Come with me. Let me turn your blood into wine.
Fine. Bring on the jazz. Let's commune. Know what?
What?
I like you, kid. Even more that you're grown.
Really?
Really. I'll travel with you, if only for a night.
I'll drive us for just as long as you want.
And I'll try to keep my hands off you while we go.
This early in August. Well, I guess the early bird does get the worm.